Good morning to respected Shefali Pandya ma'am, my dear colleagues, and all dear participants. Research is what propels humanity forward. It is fueled by curiosity. We get curious, ask questions, and immerse ourselves in discovering everything there is to know. Learning is thriving without curiosity and research. Progress would slow to a halt, and our lives as we know them would be completely different. If early civilization had not been curious about the dark sky, we would not know anything about space. Decades of research have led us to where we are today, a civilized society with the knowledge and tools to move forward. If that research slowed to a standstill, what would happen? We would become ignorant and unaware. We would not understand or go forward without research. We could not say we were close to finding the cure for cancer or find the most eco-friendly way to light up our homes and offices. We wouldn't know that even though bees are not our favorites, but they do a job that help us all. Without research, we could not possibly have survived as long as we have. And without research, we would not have hoped to survive and come out of the present dark phase of our lives also. Research is one of the few human interventions that could help humanity in coming to terms with reality and be sufficiently prepared to face the uncertainty and unpredictability of the future. And there are still millions of things that have yet to be discovered, diseases to be cured, waters to be explored, species to be discovered, scientific inventions to happen, new educational areas to be explored. All of this is possible only with research. With this background, the Center of Innovation of Gujarat Research Society's Hansraj Jeevandas College of Education has arranged this 6 days capacity building program and pre-PhD course on research methodology in social sciences. This capacity building program shall attempt to kindle the inquisitive minds of the participants and guide them through the enjoyable path of research towards the unknown frontiers of knowledge and wisdom in social sciences. Renowned resource persons and eminent scholars will elaborate on various facets of research in social sciences, which will help all the research fraternity assembled over here to take up their research work with clear goals and due diligence. We are sure that all of us are going to have an enriching experience for all these 6 days. Dear participants, on behalf of Gujarat Research Society's Hansraj Jeevandas College of Education, our principal Dr. Anita Swamy, entire JCE family, I extend a warm welcome to you all. And to begin this journey of exploring the various facets of research, we do have an eminent educationist and research scholar who herself is an institution when it comes to research. And she is none other than our dear Dr. Shefali Pandya ma'am, who shall discuss the topic research question, objectives, and hypothesis. I take proud privilege in introducing Dr. Pandya to you all. I'm sure all of you know Dr. Pandya, but I still take I consider it as my privilege to introduce her to you all. Dr. Pandya is senior professor and head Department of Education, University of Mumbai. She has got 31 years of teaching experience at PG level, 10 years of administrative experience as professor and head Department of Education, University of Mumbai, IC head Department of Education, SNDT Women's University, IC Head, Department of Physical Education, University of Mumbai, IC Director, Institute of Distance and Open Learning, University of Mumbai. Dr. Pandya has taken independent research projects, various independent research projects which were funded by UGC, University with Potential for Excellence Scheme, and again funded by UGC on a major research projects. Dr. Pandya has immense international exposure. She has traveled to UK, USA, France, Australia, Japan, South Africa, Singapore, Thailand, Nepal, and has presented 14 research papers over there. There are many, I will say, varied academic achievements of Dr. Pandya. I'll just name some of them. Dr. Pandya has successfully guided 42 PhD students. Plus the Viva, some of the students are awaiting their Viva. Dr. Pandya has again successfully guided 15 MPhil students. Dr. Pandya has published 145 papers in international and national renowned journals. Dr. Pandya has published 16 books in diverse areas, mainly related to education. Dr. Pandya has addressed or delivered valedictory addresses, and she has been keynote speakers at 14, I'll say, occasions. She has been invited as resource persons at 66 occasions also. She has been a member of various publications. She has been a reviewer of various publications, international. I'll name that reviewer of publications owned by various countries like Canada, USA, Africa, Turkestan, South Korea. The list is so long. The list is so long. Dr. Pandya has got additional experience also because she has been on various committees in different capacities. I'll just name some of them because the list is very long. She has been a member of the NACPIR team. She has been a member of NCT committees. She has been a member of IQAC of different colleges. She has been a member of Senate, University of Mumbai, elected member of that. She has been a member of Board of Studies in Education in the University of Mumbai also. The list is, if I look at the number, the list is so long. It is more than 40 committees she has been there. Ma'am has almost organized 23 seminars, conferences, and workshops at different levels again. She has organized webinars also. And she has organized refresher courses under UGC Academic College, Staff College for University of Mumbai. Dear participants, if I read out the entire credentials and achievements of ma'am, I'm sure that I'm going to take more than half an hour. I'm going to say minimum more than half an hour, but I don't want to come in between you and ma'am. So ma'am, it is our proud privilege to have you today with us and to start this journey of exploring research in social sciences as our first resource person. Ma'am, on behalf of Gujarat Research Societies, Hansraj Jeevandas College of Education, our principal, Dr. Anita Swamy, entire HJC team, including the team of Center for Innovation, and our all participants, I extend the warmest welcome to you, ma'am. And we are looking forward to have an enriching session with you as always. So I request you, ma'am, to begin with the session. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, Dr. Karuna. First of all, I thank HJ College, Dr. Swamy, Dr. Karuna, and the entire team HJ for inviting me, all of you here. Of course, Dr. I can see Dr. Usha Borkar here and Dr. Kadgeri also here. Thank you once again for inviting me.
Ma'am, it is the team, Center for Innovation team.
Sorry?
Ma'am, it is the team, Center for Innovation ka team.
Okay, fine. Thank you. in a mood to listen to music just now? Anyway, as you all know, my topic today is research questions, objectives and hypotheses. And I won't be giving much theoretical inputs, a little bit of theoretical inputs, but would prefer to have a workshop format. And I'll finish some part and then give you some work, again, some part and some work. So that is what I plan to do. And in today's session, I hope to cover these aspects: writing research questions, what, why, and how type of questions, what questions and aims of research, why questions and aims of research, how questions and aims of research, classification of research questions, how to write research questions, linking title, research questions, aims and objectives, meaning, yeah, functions and hypotheses.
Archana ma'am, who is this making noise?
Patil. I'm trying to mute them because, but they are again unmuting. So ma'am, what I'll do, I mute everyone. Okay, the common
except, ma'am. This. Except ma'am.
No, Karuna ma'am, madam will have to unmute herself. Okay, hey, ma'am, I'll do that. Yeah. Yeah, ma'am, you can try now. Shefali ma'am.
Yeah. And I'll be taking four types of hypothesis: directional, non-directional, null, and statistical hypothesis. And of course, at the end, I will try to show how we link aims of the study with the methodology. So this is my today's plan of what I want to include in today's session. Am I audible? Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am. You're perfectly audible, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Very clearly.
And can you see the screen?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Fine. Now, writing research questions. Why do we need to write research questions? Because a research question helps us to select the focus of the study and the direction in which we want to go. It helps us to decide the scope and delimitations. It also helps us to determine the research methodology and how we are going to manage the study. So this is the purpose of writing research questions. The success of any research study depends on the foundation of its research questions. If research questions are very clear and sound, then the entire study would be conducted very well. You can have one or more than one research questions. There is no limit to it. Actually, research is a very creative endeavor, and therefore we cannot put restrictions on number of research questions. Similar is the case with research objectives. There are some universities which put a restriction such as you can have write only two research objectives, but in a creative endeavor, you cannot put that. It depends on the scope of the study and the kind of study that you are conducting. So you cannot have restrictions on research, number of research questions or number of research objectives. That would be very unfair to the entire study at hand. Both quantitative and qualitative research can have research questions. However, generally, research questions is a compulsory component of a qualitative study. You may or may not have it in quantitative study. Why? I'll tell you the reason. In quantitative study, we generally write objectives and hypotheses. We test each hypothesis, and the findings and results of the study are written in terms of whether a hypothesis is accepted or rejected. Whereas when you write research questions, your findings would be written in the form of answers to those research questions. So in a quantitative study, writing research questions becomes a little tricky. However, there is no harm in writing research questions, even in quantitative studies. So you can write research questions in both quantitative or qualitative studies, but in qualitative research, it is a must. And where do we write research questions? Generally, at the end of introduction or after literature review or in a separate section of the study. It depends on the pattern that your university follows. Okay, next. What is a research question? So according to Mason, research questions should be clearly formulated, whether or not you intend to modify them or add to them later. Very often my students, when they prepare a proposal, they submit it to the university thesis section. It gets approved by RRC. And when they start doing the work, sometimes I make them change. So they are extremely scared. No, but we didn't have this in the research proposal. There is no harm in changing research questions in the research proposal. It's perfectly okay if you, at a later stage, you want to modify a research question or add a few more questions. It's absolutely fine. There is no problem. You cannot touch your title once RRC has approved, but the other parts you can change, but you can't touch the title. They are intellectually worthwhile and researchable in terms of your epistemological position as well as in practical terms. Because it is through research questions that you will be connecting what it is that you wish to research with how you are going to go about researching it. They are the vehicles which you will rely upon to move you from your broad research interests to your specific research focus. Your research interest might be very broad. For example, ashram shala, ashram school. That's a broad research interest. But for your research, you may have taken a specific aspect of ashram schools. So that focus is brought about by research questions. And therefore, they are important. Then, research questions are those questions to which you as a researcher really want to know the answers. And in that sense, they are the formal expression of your intellectual puzzle, your question that you have in your mind about a specific academic aspect. Okay, so that was about writing research questions. Now we go to the three types of research questions. There are, in general, three types of research questions. What questions, why questions, and how questions. Let's look at the first one, what questions. In a research, the aim of the study is to provide description. That is, the study will be descriptive. So if you want to answer questions which begin with what, you are describing something. So you are conducting a descriptive research. You are discovering something or describing something. What are the characteristics of an effective educational leader? What type of people generally prefer the teaching profession? So your questions are what? They begin with what? And in that case, you are trying to discover and describe the characteristics of and pattern in some specific educational aspect or phenomenon. It may be specific individuals like students, teachers, principals, or it can be specific groups or educational processes. So in a descriptive study, you may have what questions, and the purpose is only to discover and describe, nothing more. The next we come to is why questions. These are aimed at identifying the causes or reasons of the existence of characteristics of or regularities in a particular phenomenon. For example, what kind of students are high achievers? If you ask, that will be what questions, descriptive. But if you want to find out the factors influencing, factors related to or associated with high academic achievement, it would be why questions. Such researches are explanatory. They provide an explanation. Why some students achieve well and some students don't achieve well. They are directed towards understanding or explaining the relationship between events or within educational activities and processes. So that's about why questions. Often we have why questions in our research study. For example, why do some teachers are more effective? Or what are the characteristics of effective teachers and ineffective teachers? So that gives you a reason why some teachers are effective. So that's why questions. And the third one is how questions. These are concerned with bringing about change with practical intervention programs and outcomes. And usually these are associated with experimental research. So this is how the study, the research questions are written. Some research questions may begin with what, some may begin with why, and some may begin with how. These are the three different types of research questions that you have. Does anyone have any question? You can raise your hand and then you will be unmuted.
Yes, Pandya ma'am, will you be taking the questions in between now? They have posed two questions. Okay, ma'am. I'll just read it out, ma'am.
They are written in the chat?
Yes, ma'am, in the chat box. But there are many messages, so I'll just read it out for yourself, ma'am. 1 minute. Ma'am, one question is, please give some practical examples of research questions, importance of their specific wording. Ma'am, I think you gave the examples for every what, why, and how.
I still have some more.
Okay, ma'am, sure.
I still have answer to these questions. Okay, the next is what questions and aims. What type of questions and aims? Okay, so this will have examples and it will also give you an idea of how to write the aim of the study based on the type of research question. Now, these all questions begin with what? The first, second column, if you see, what research questions? Just read them. What type of people become school teachers or college teachers? What are their presage characteristics in terms of IQ, subject knowledge, values, beliefs, attitude towards teaching profession? What is their characteristic classroom behavior? What teacher education or training processes have brought about this behavior? What are the patterns in the relationship between their presage characteristics and their classroom behavior? What are the consequences of the classroom behavior of teachers? I think this answers your questions, whosoever had posed this question. You can write in the chat box. I'm looking at the chat box if you want.
Yeah, they have written down, yes. They've written down, yes.
Yeah, presage characteristics means when you enter the teaching profession, whatever characteristics you bring with you in the teaching profession at that entry point is called presage. Pre, matlab entry ke pehle. Before you enter, whatever characteristics you have, it's called presage characteristics. Good. If you don't know the term, you can ask. Nobody knows everything in life. Yeah. Okay. Now, based on these questions, how do we write aim of the study? So let us look at each question. First question, what type of people become school teachers? So the aim of the study would be to study the background of school teachers. What are their presage characteristics? So the aim of the study is to ascertain the level of their IQ, subject knowledge, values, beliefs, and attitude towards the teaching profession. What is their characteristic classroom behavior? Aim to observe and describe their verbal and nonverbal classroom behavior. What teacher education processes have brought about this behavior? To study the components of teacher education program that brings about this behavior. What are the patterns in the relationship between their presage characteristics of the teachers? To ascertain the relationship between their presage characteristics and their classroom behavior. What are the consequences of the classroom behavior of teachers? To study the consequences of verbal and nonverbal classroom behavior of teachers. So this is how we write what research questions and aim of the study, corresponding aim of the study. Now we will go to the next one. Now we look at why type of questions. Why do some students delinquent? Why do some students become delinquent? Aim of the study would be to study the reasons for delinquency among secondary school students. Next question, why does parental anxiety lead to high level of stress in students of standard 10th? Aim would be to identify parental behaviors arising on account of their anxiety that lead to high levels of stress in students of standard 10th. Why does the level of motivation among teachers change during their teaching career? See, it's very natural when you are new to the profession, new teacher, this year only you have got the job, your motivation may be very high. Then over a period of time, you have negative experiences. So your motivation level may go down. And at the time of retirement, some people may become highly motivated again. Some may lose their motivation even further. It depends on your temperament and the kind of experiences that you have. So level of motivation, why does it change among teachers during their teaching career? An aim would be to study the reasons for the change in the level of motivation among teachers at different stages in their career, such as while on probation, before promotion, and at retirement time. Fourth, why do TV viewing habits influence career choice of students? An aim of the study would be to study the reasons for students' career choices being influenced by their TV viewing habits. So this is why questions and the corresponding aim. There is some chat question. Let me read. So why contains the factors affecting? Yes, yes, yes. The next, how questions and aims of the study. How can students' academic performance in mathematics be enhanced? I am a maths teacher and I want to improve performance of my students in my subject, my mathematics. So how can I do, how do I change my method of teaching so that their performance in mathematics increases? And the corresponding aim of the study would be to study the effectiveness of inquiry training model in enhancing students' academic performance in mathematics. Second question, how can the rate of educational equity be enhanced? An aim of the study would be to identify and study ways of enhancing educational opportunity and equity in the Indian society for the disadvantaged sections. So this is how you write what questions, why questions, and how questions. And for each type of question, I have shown you how to write aim of the study. I believe all of you are currently doing your PhD, etc. So now I give you some work. What is why question is for causal comparative research. Why question is usually for experimental research. You can have what, why, and how questions in the same study, but then the study may become too unmanageable. There is no harm in keeping, but it becomes unmanageable then. Now, since this is a workshop format, I have given you three types of questions. You identify your study and give me at least two questions. That question could be what type, how type, or why type. It depends on you and your study. But I give you 5 minutes. You first write down, then raise your hand, and then answer the question. Am I clear? Or should I write in the chat box?
Ma'am, I'm doing that for you, ma'am. I'm typing okay. In the chat box.
Any two questions? Any two
yes,
questions?
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Yeah?
Ma'am?
Yeah?
Yeah, one participant, I think, has a doubt. Nishad Imam has raised the hand. Yes, Nishad, you can unmute.
Okay. No, I didn't have a doubt. I was wanted to share the question. The question that I have prepared, can I share that?
You should not write in the chat box. You just read aloud so that everyone can hear and we can discuss.
Yeah, so, I raised the hand.
No, but to share the question. One minute. You have already written two questions, but wait for 2-3 minutes. Let others finish and then we'll discuss.
Ma'am.
Okay?
Okay, ma'am.
Thank you. If you are finished, we can discuss now. Who would like to read out?
Yes, ma'am. They have raised their hands. I'll just unmute one by one, ma'am.
Yes.
Since Nishat wanted to share first.
Yeah. Ma'am, my question that I have prepared is, what will be the effect of differentiated instruction on the learning of mathematics for primary grade students?
Are you just describing the effect? Or is it an experimental study?
Experimental study.
So,
what will be the effect? So, I'm going to conduct a module and I will be seeing the effect. So, what will be the effect of learning mathematics? What will be the effect of a differentiated instruction, DI, on the learning of mathematics for primary grade students?
And your aim of the, okay, fine. Have you written aim of the study?
Yeah, the aim of the study is to study the effect of DI on learning of mathematics, on achievement of mathematics of primary grade students.
Ideally, what questions are written only for describing, but that's okay. We are not so hard and fast as far as research goes, so long as the meaning is conveyed. I wanted two questions. So what is second question?
My second question is, how can the learning of children be improved with online instructions?
Is it the same study?
No. I have looked at another online instruction, effect of online instruction.
My purpose was, you can take your own study and then write so that side by side your work also gets over. Anyway, your question is not wrong. And the aim of the study?
And the aim of study is to look at the effect of various tools being used in online instruction. So which tool is most effective?
Please read the question again.
How can the learning of the children be improved with online instructions?
And corresponding aim?
Corresponding aim is to provide various tools and see the effectiveness of the various tools, online tools available for learning and teaching, to see the effectiveness of the tool, to study the effect of various online tools available for learning.
Your first one was okay. Your second question and aim do not match. You you can revise it.
One more doubt I had, ma'am. Can there be a question starting from is or will or do? Will there be a change in attitude? For example, do the teachers teaching mathematics have the skills? Can we start a question with something like that besides the three?
Yes. You can start.
Okay, thank you.
Next one.
Parveen Khan, can you please share your question?
Yeah. Thank you, ma'am. How can an effective professional development module enhance the performance of the primary school teacher? That's fine. My question.
Fine.
My aim could be to design and evaluate the effectiveness of a professional development module on the perform on for primary school teachers.
Okay, fine. Second?
I have just done one, ma'am. What could be the related? I am not able to get the second one.
That's why I gave you time, no? That's the reason why I gave you five.
Able to figure out, ma'am, how, I mean, it's, could you guide me?
Okay, I'll give you further recommendation,
and
you'll do it, right?
Okay.
Next one.
Bindiya, can you ask your question?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you so much. Ma'am, I have written, how can the student stress level be reduced using online teaching? Corresponding aim I have written as to study the effectiveness of online teaching on stress levels of the students.
Okay. To study the?
to study the effectiveness of online teaching on stress levels of the students?
Just put effect, not effectiveness.
Yes, ma'am. Okay, ma'am. Okay, ma'am.
Because effect this... could be if online teaching may increase the stress also. In that okay. case, online teaching is not.
Yes, ma'am. Okay, ma'am.
Yeah.
And the second one, ma'am, how can student engagement be improved in online teaching? Again, I've written to study the effectiveness of online teaching on student engagement.
Better write effect rather than effectiveness.
Otherwise, it's fine.
Next.
Atmaja, can you please share your question?
Yes, ma'am. Am I audible, ma'am?
Yes, Atmaja.
Yes.
Thank you, ma'am. My first question is, what is the influence of organization policies on teachers' leadership skills? And the aim related to that is to study relationship between organizational policies and teachers' leadership skills in a secondary school.
Just read the question again.
What is the influence of organization policies on teachers' leadership skills?
And in the aim, you have written the word relationship, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Here there is a problem. In the question, you are writing effect, which implies an experimental study. Whereas in the aim, you are writing the relationship, which shows descriptive research. Therefore, the question does not match your aim.
So, what changes shall I make in that question or?
See this. Can you see this?
Yes, ma'am.
Or alternatively, can you see here somewhere something that matches? See number 5.
What are the patterns in the relationship between their pre-sage characteristics?
You will have organization and leadership skills.
Yes, ma'am.
Right? Then corresponding.
Yes, ma'am. Got the idea. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. The word influence, effect, or impact are usually used in experimental research. So if you are planning to use experimental research, only then use the words like effect, influence, or impact.
Okay, madam. Yes, very much clear, ma'am.
Otherwise, do not use these things. Okay, fine. Yeah.
Yes, ma'am. Yes,
anyone
ma'am.
Else?
Shall I say?
Yeah.
Ma'am, second question, anyone shall else? I?
Pucho. Bolo.
Ma'am, second question. How does teachers' beliefs influence their classroom practices? It is from the same study. How does teachers... and teachers' classroom practices in secondary schools?
Do you think your question matches your aim?
Not exactly, ma'am. I understood again the mistake. as I did in earlier one.
Yeah, if you have understood, fine. Wonderful.
Yes, yes, ma'am. Thank you.
Do your, it's okay. So, shall I go to the next one?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Ma'am, can I try one question?
Lubna.
Bolo na.
Yes, Lubna, please go ahead.
What is the emotional quotient, cultural quotient, and adversity quotient of secondary school teachers? The aim would be to study and analyze all the cues of the secondary school teachers of three boards.
Analyze or describe?
Analyze.
I think, ma'am, I don't know. Yeah, there is some cross connection. Sushmita, are you asking the question? Yes, please go ahead. Yes.
Yeah. My first one, the question is, how the economic background of the students affect online education? The aim is to find ways and means to reach out to every student. This is the first question.
Okay.
And the second question is, how can students cope with virtual classroom to find students' coping mechanism for these online classes and exams?
Just read the first question and corresponding aim.
First one is how the economic background of the students affect online education. Aim is to find...
One minute. Are you conducting an experimental study?
Yes.
Can you change, what is your dependent variable?
Dependent is the economic background. Online education is the thing which is affected by the economic background.
Just read again.
How the economic background of the students affect online education.
Acha. How will you measure online education?
We can measure it by the tests conducted, the exams.
Are you studying satisfaction in online education? Are you studying engagement in student engagement in online education? Are you studying effectiveness of an online education? Which aspect are you studying?
Online education.
So you are studying in terms of marks obtained in online education?
In this case, we can restrict to marks.
We mean you.
Because that defines the success in their studies, the theoretical study.
Okay. Now you want to study students' background and its effect on online education, right?
Yeah, economic background.
Students' economic background is the independent variable. Am I right?
Yeah.
If it is an experiment, can you change students' economic background? Do you have the capacity to change anyone's economic background?
No, we cannot change the background, but we want to
see. It is not an experimental study. No, beta. It is not an experimental study. What you can do is find out their marks in online education. That is okay. But you can compare students' performance in online education on the basis of economic background, on their economic background.
Okay, ma'am.
It cannot use the word effect because you cannot change anyone's economic background. Right, Peter?
Yeah.
Right? Yeah. You understood what I'm trying to say?
Yeah. Means in terms of their salary of their parents, we can define it.
you can define, but you can't change any salary, no?
Yes, we can't change. Can find ways and
means. So you cannot change anyone's salary, therefore you cannot use the word effect.
Okay, ma'am.
That is
my second question was, how can students cope with virtual classroom? Aim is to find students' coping mechanisms. How can students cope with virtual classroom? And aim is to find the students' coping mechanism. How they can
cope with... So you just write what are the coping mechanisms of students in a virtual classroom? Simple.
Yeah.
And corresponding aim?
Aim is to find out what ways they are finding out. Suppose they are having no smartphone. So they are finding friends who can help them out. They can share phone and go for online systems, like this kind of things.
Here, tell me, how will you write this coping mechanism question and the aim?
What are the coping mechanisms in virtual classroom? And aim is to find out how students can...
Is there any example which uses the word find out?
We can have a questionnaire asking them how they attend online class.
You just read aims, which I have written 5 examples of aim, 6 examples of aim. Do they write the word find out?
Yeah, we can. Ma'am, then what do you suggest, ma'am? Yeah.
You can write to observe and describe the coping mechanisms of students in virtual classrooms.
Okay, ma'am.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am.
Ma'am, 5 more have raised their hands. What should we do, ma'am?
No, I'll go ahead with my slides. I'll give them a chance later on.
Sure, ma'am. Yes.
Yeah. Often there is a sequence in these 3 types of questions. Usually, first few research questions focus on what, then why, and then how. So if you have more than one questions, first question would be what type, second would be why type, and third would be how type. This is because we first need to know what is happening. Then only we can explain what is happening. And then we can find out how that can be changed. So first we understand what is happening. Then we try to explain why it is happening. And then we can find out how we can change what is happening. So always write what questions first, then why, and then how. Usually. However, you must note that researchers aimed at answering any of these 3 types of questions can be equally useful and significant. Sometimes your study may only focus on what questions, sometimes only on why questions, and sometimes only on how questions. Sometimes can have a mix of 2 or more type of questions. So it's perfectly okay in any study. We go to the next one, classification of research questions. If Dr. Sinha is there, is it till 1:30 or is it till 2 o'clock?
Ma'am, if you want to extend, please, half an hour is always welcome. Please, ma'am.
No, 1:30
ka hai, but if we take a little bit of more time, that is always, we can adjust that. It's not an issue at all.
No, because I didn't expect so many questions.
No worries, ma'am. Please, ma'am. No worries. It is for their benefit. All of us are going to get benefited, ma'am.
Okay.
No worries.
Classification of research question is the next point. There are three types of research questions. One are descriptive questions. Generally, in a descriptive survey type, they are used. Like, what is the achievement level of students of standard 4? What are the participants' opinions of refresher course in special education? What are the attitudes of teachers towards inclusive education? Which of the alternative bus routes do the parents prefer for their children? What do the teachers perceive as the student's most important need? Or the example which the last person gave, what are the coping mechanisms of students in a virtual classroom? So these are all descriptive questions. Then there is relationship questions, which imply a correlational design. Is self-concept related to achievement? What are the predictors of college success? These are all research questions aimed at finding out relationship between two variables. Somebody had that relationship question. Somebody discussed, can I go back to the same person who had question pertaining to relationship between two variables? Silence.
Participants, none of you had asked a question pertaining to the relationship. Madam wants to know that.
Third one.
But can, ma'am, there can be a question in this, is there a relationship of emotional quotient, of can it be that the relation quotient, emotional quotient with cultural quotient and other quotients, ma'am? Is there any relationship?
What are the interrelationship between emotional quotient,
cultural quotient, adversity quotient, and empathy quotient?
Are these four types of quotients interrelated? You can ask. Yes, you can ask. Difference questions, by a causal comparative or ex post facto or even experimental design. Causal comparative research, ex post facto research or experimental research. Is there a difference between two or more groups, two or more treatments or two or more data sets? Is there a difference between pretest and post-test scores? That online education one who asked, you can ask this kind of question. Is there a difference between pretest and post-test scores in online education on the basis of economic background of students? That kind of question could be asked here. Because she was doing an experimental design. So the question would be of this type. Do you have is this clear or shall I give some more example?
Ma'am, I have one doubt here. Can I?
Yeah.
During our coursework, we were asked not to make is kind of question, like is there is a difference? Because usually such questions have a yes or no answer. Yes, there is a difference. No, there is a difference. There is not a difference. So we were asked to...
That is true. It is true. There is an answer in yes or no. What is wrong with that?
They were asking us to construct the sentence as what is the difference between pretest and post-test, something of that sort.
What question? Okay.
Ma'am, I have a question. Can I ask?
Eight minutes. They means who?
Sorry, ma'am.
They were asking, matlab?
I was doing my coursework and our teachers had asked us to frame the question as
all teachers or one teacher? All teachers or one teacher?
Two or three of them, ma'am.
All of them taught the same thing?
No. They were different. So that is why I'm asking you this question. Is it okay to have a is or question? or is it compulsory that we have a what, how kind of a question?
Absolutely. It's okay.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you.
Any other question?
Ma'am, I have a question. So if we frame the question as to what extent, we talk about one variable and its effect on the other variable, and we use the word as to what extent, will that work or will that be too much of a work?
No, there are two, three things. Your first, if it is an experimental research, your first question will be, is there a difference between pre-test and post-test scores?
Okay.
If yes, then what is the magnitude of that effectiveness?
Okay. Yeah. Understood.
See, if your post-test score is higher than pre-test, it means your treatment or intervention program is effective. Yes? It's good.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So if it is effective, then what is the magnitude of the effectiveness or extent of effectiveness?
Okay.
So, question, whether there is a difference or not, whether it is effective or not.
Okay.
Second question would be extent or magnitude of effectiveness. So, you will have two questions.
Okay. Thank you.
See, somebody was asking whether is there a difference.
Okay.
In social science, there are no hard and fast rules. In many of the researches in Mumbai University, we write, even for experimental research, there is no significant difference between pre-test and post-test scores. Now, this went to somebody from another university as a referee, and that lady rejected, saying, you should write, there is no significant effect of. So, as there is a saying in Sanskrit, tunde tunde matir binna. But it does not mean this is wrong. Next, how to write research questions. Write down every question you can think of. Whatever comes to your mind, brainstorming technique, you write down first. You think or you discuss it with someone, both of you feel together. Write down all the questions that comes to your mind and your friend's mind or your guide's mind. Now that list can have what questions, why questions or how questions. So first write down everything. Even if you feel this is impractical, this is stupid, this is not possible, even then you write it down. Then you review the list of questions. First classify, put all kinds of what questions together, why questions together, and how questions together, classify them. Then you read each type of question and reread, and if required, rewrite, modify. Sometimes you can combine one or more questions. Even that is possible. Now you have refined all your questions, so they will become very specific. Then you can decide, these questions now are relevant, these are irrelevant. So the irrelevant question, put it aside. Now look at the assumptions. Before selecting the why or how questions, check whether the answers to the what questions are available or not. If you are looking at coping mechanisms, first question should be, what are the coping mechanisms? And then you can select how these coping mechanisms influence academic performance of students. So first find out whether what question answers to what questions are available or not. Only then you can try why or how questions. That what questions could come from your research or some prior research also, or some theoretical framework also, that's okay. But answers to what questions must be available before you go to why or how questions. Then examine the scope of the questions. Be very practical. while selecting the scope of the questions. Do not be overambitious or do not be too limited. It should be manageable and feasible. Then main questions or major questions, primary questions, and secondary or subsidiary questions, that you separate out. Major or primary questions are those which forms the core, most important part of the investigation. Key questions. Whereas subsidiary questions are those that deal with the background information or issues that are presupposed by one or more major questions. For example, if you are studying effect of online learning, then the major question is, what is the effect of online learning on students' academic performance and student engagement? And subsidiary question would be, is there a gender difference in effect of online learning? It means, is online learning equally effective for boys and girls both? That becomes a subsidiary question, because that does not form the core of your study. So it becomes subsidiary. Generally, it's not a rule, but generally, the major research question gives you the aim of the study, and subsidiary questions give us the objectives of the study. The seventh step is find out, critically evaluate whether each question that you have listed out is necessary or not. Scrutinize. What is the importance of each question that you scrutinize? That is how you write all the research questions. Now, how will you link your title of the study, your research question, your aims and objectives? So after this step, I will give you some exercise again. I'm giving you some examples. Title: a study of students' attitude towards school in relation to their classroom climate. This is my title. Major research question: what is the relationship between students' attitude towards the school and their perceived classroom climate? Now look at the title. Title uses the word in relation to. Therefore, research question also uses the word relationship between. And based on major research question, I can write my aim: to ascertain the relationship between students' attitude towards the school and their perceived classroom climate. So now, my work to all of you is, you write the title of your study, your major research question, and one broad aim. I'll give you 5 minutes. Have you finished? Have you finished?
Yes.
Yes, ma'am. Seven of them.
Yes, ma'am.
Raise their hands.
I want for each one, I want title, one major question and corresponding aim.
Should we start, ma'am? Should I ask them to chair?
Okay.
So, ma'am, this time we'll go by the ones who didn't get the chance earlier. First, we give them the chance. Shilpa, Shilpa Gandhi, please yes, share ma'am. Your question.
Yes, thank you, ma'am. Thank you. Madam, the title of the study I'm suggesting, a study of the effectiveness of financial literacy program on financial management skills of high school students. Research question would therefore be how to improve the ability of high school students to take financial decisions. The broad aim would be to measure the effectiveness of the financial literacy program on enhancing financial decision-making skills among high school students.
Okay. Next.
Next, Yasmin, would you like to share your question? I think, ma'am, Yasmin is not there, so we go to the next.
So,
Bindiya, would you like to share your question?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, the title of the study is A Study of Learner Attitude Towards Online Learning in Relation to Their Engagement in Learning. And the research question is, what is the relationship between learner attitude towards online learning and their engagement in learning? And the aim I've written is to ascertain the relationship between learner attitude towards online learning and their engagement in learning.
Correct. I would like to point out one thing here. If you look at the title, the broad aim, the title is usually a study of, and broad aim generally with two. So it's, no, I'm telling everyone, not just to you.
Yes.
And the broad starts with to study, to ascertain, to compare. Often there are people who write their title in terms of to study. This is wrong. You are not writing the objective or aim. Title does not begin with to study. Title never begins with to study. Okay. Yeah. Anyone else would like to share?
Yes, ma'am. Can I share?
Sure.
Yeah. My title is Effect of Teacher Training in Differentiated Instruction on the Learning of Mathematics at Student Level in Inclusive Classrooms. My major research question is, what will be the effect of differentiated instruction module in teaching learning process of mathematics in inclusive classrooms? The broad aim is to develop and ascertain the effect of differentiated module on the learning of mathematics in inclusive classroom.
What is the broad aim? Would you please repeat?
Broad aim is to develop a module, to develop and ascertain the effect of differentiated instruction module on the learning of mathematics in inclusive classroom.
Sorry, what is the initial words? Okay, next, anyone else?
Is it okay, ma'am?
Yes, yes.
Thank you.
Ma'am, can may I?
Yeah.
Good morning, ma'am. My title is The Effect of Constructivist Approach in History Education on Study, Academic Achievement and Their Attitude Toward the Subject. Major research question is, does the constructivist approach having any effect on students' academic achievement in history? And major aim of the study is, the study aims to find the impact of constructivist approach in history education on students' academic achievement and their attitude towards the subject. Is that okay, ma'am?
Fine.
Ma'am, can
yes,
I come?
Can I?
And go to the next one now.
Can I?
Okay. Last one, please.
Yeah. Ma'am, my title of the research is Effect of Differentiated Instructional Strategies on the Academic Achievement, Classroom Climate, and Social Cohesion of Higher Secondary School Students. So my the research question is, what is the impact of differentiated instructional strategies on the academic achievement of students? And the broad aim would be to study the effect of differentiated instructional strategies on the academic achievement of the students.
Ma'am, one more, can I come in?
Thank you.
Ma'am, can I come in? Mm-hmm. Yeah, so ma'am, my title is Developing an Evaluation of a Training Model for the Continuous Professional Development of Primary School Teachers. My major question, can mm-hmm. it start with how to develop and evaluate a training model for continuous professional development of primary school teachers? And my broad aim is how to develop and evaluate a training model for the continuous professional development of primary school teachers.
Just read the title again.
Development and evaluation of a training model for the continuous professional development of primary school teachers. I'm a little confused about my major research question. Will it be how to or to find the effectiveness? I don't know.
What is the effect of that module on continuous professional?
Okay, ma'am. And my broad aim is to develop and evaluate a training model for the CPD of the primary school teacher. That would be.
And test its effectiveness.
And test
its effectiveness.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Next.
Ma'am, can I?
Participants, yeah. We request you, participants. Towards the end, if the time permits, definitely ma'am will be listening to all the...
Or you can read out the subsidiary research questions now. See, in the previous slide, I showed you major research question, right? Now, subsidiary research questions. What are the dimensions? What was my title? My title was A Study of Students' Attitude Towards School in Relation to Their Classroom Climate. Major research question, what is the relationship between attitude towards school and perceived classroom climate? And broad aim is to ascertain the relationship between attitude towards school and their classroom climate. Now I go to subsidiary research questions, which gives me objectives of the study. What are the dimensions of classroom climate as perceived by students? Are there any gender difference, male, female? in the students' attitude towards school and perceived classroom climate? Are there any differences in students' attitude towards school and classroom climate based on schools from different types of management, that is aided schools, unaided schools, central schools, and municipal schools? Then fourth is, what is the relationship of students' attitude towards school with classroom climate? So these are my subsidiary questions. Those are four. I have two more. Are there any gender differences, boy, male, female, in relationship of students' attitude towards the school with classroom climate? And are there any differences in this relationship between these two variables on the basis of in aided schools, unaided schools, central schools, and municipal schools? So if you look at now, go back to the original. One title, one major question, and one broad aim. And four and two, six subsidiary questions. So for one broad aim, I have six objectives, six specific objectives. This is how I write: to study classroom climate on the following dimensions.
What cycle challenge? Yes, it is great.
Shefali ma'am, what I am doing again, I am muting everyone, and I request you to please unmute yourself now. Yes, ma'am.
To ascertain gender differences in students' attitude towards school and classroom climate. To ascertain differences in attitude towards school and classroom climate based on school types, aided, unaided, central, and municipal. Then I have three more. To ascertain the relationship of attitude towards school and classroom climate, ascertain gender differences in this relationship, and ascertain differences in relationship based on school types. So one major research question and one broad aim. Six subsidiary research questions and six objectives. So now all of you have written your title. Earlier exercise, you have written your title, major research question and broad aim. Now for the same title, research question and aim, write subsidiary questions. You can have two or more depending on you. I'm giving you 10 minutes now, because this is a longer exercise, and after 10 minutes, we'll come back. Write research questions, subsidiary research questions, and corresponding objectives. 10 minutes are over. Is anyone ready?
Yes, ma'am. Sushmita has raised her hand and even Neha Gupta. So, Sushmita, would you like to share? Yes, Sushmita, I have unmuted everyone.
Yes, ma'am.
You can just try now.
Yes, ma'am. Now, am I audible?
Yes.
Yes. The title is Coping Mechanism of Students in Online Education. Major research question is, what is the relationship of coping mechanism of students and their previous grades? Broad aim of the study to establish the relationship of the coping mechanism and their previous grades. Subsidiary questions. Does the medium of the school have an influence? Does residency in city or villages have an effect? Does gender of the student matter? Does type of the student school, aided or unaided, have an influence? Whether teachers' motivation helps them? Whether parents' motivation helps them? That's it, ma'am. Thank you.
Helps what? Helps coping mechanism or helps performance in online education?
No, coping mechanism of students in online education.
Okay, and what are the corresponding objectives of the study?
Objectives are the relationship of coping mechanism of students and their previous grades.
Objective always begins with two.
Yeah, to find the relationship between the coping mechanism of the student and previous grades of the child or the student.
You had some four or five subsidiary questions. So you have, for each one, you need to have an objective.
Okay. So does the medium of the school have an influence in their...
Yeah, I'm not asking you now subsidiary research question. I'm asking you to read out objective. Each objective begins with the word two.
Yeah, to find the relationship between the medium of the school and their grades.
Are you assuming that the relationship is there?
No, there should not be any relationship.
You can't use the word find.
Okay.
Find implies that you know the relationship exists. It may not exist, so you can't use find.
Okay. To study mm-hmm. the effect of the medium of the school on the previous grades.
Find the?
To study the effect of, or to study the relationship between, no, that won't be. To study the relation between medium of the school and their previous grades.
Mm-hmm.
That can be one objective. And the second one is...
And one minute. What was the corresponding subsidiary research question?
Does the medium of the school have an influence?
Influence? Are you conducting an experiment?
No, only a study.
So you cannot use the word influence, impact, effect.
Okay, ma'am.
Professional study.
Okay, ma'am. So does the medium of the school have an effect? We can write?
No effect.
Okay. Then to study the medium. We can relate this to the coping mechanism. How does the medium of the school or relation of the medium of the school and coping mechanism of the student in online?
That would be comparison.
Okay. Then Ma'am, we can have this question as a subsidiary research question. Is it okay to have such a question? Yes, ma'am?
You need to word it properly.
Okay.
You need to be very clear whether you are conducting an experiment. If yes, then you can use the word effect or impact or influence. If it is a correlational study, then you use the word relationship between variables. If it is a causal comparative or exposed factor, you are comparing. So you first decide what type of your study you are doing.
Okay, ma'am. If it is an experiment in this case, what is the difference? Like, I have not got that. If it is only
what,
a study.
What exactly, how do you want to conduct the experiment?
Through the use of questionnaires. By questionnaire.
Describe. Describe your study.
Suppose I have a questionnaire to all the students of different sections of the different medium, different residential places like city or urban, urban or rural, then a different gender.
What is the experiment about? What is the experiment about?
We want to find out whether this students are coping with this online education or not, from different sections or different sectors, whether they are able to
cope with it. How does it become an experiment?
Experiment, it, I'm not very clear about this as to how this can become an experiment and how.
You need to read up a lot.
Okay, ma'am.
You require more about what you are studying.
Oh, okay, okay.
Yeah. Anyone else would like to read out?
Okay, thank you, ma'am.
Neha?
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am. Am I audible?
Yeah.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yes.
Ma'am, my topic is a study of customers' attitude towards the marketing strategy of strategy skills of in relation to their needs of customer. Because needs of customers, customer needs means here my objectives is to know the different types of marketing skills which affect the customers' perceptions and to know the customers' needs which enhance to improve the marketing skills. These two aims I had made and the subsidiary research, just like you showed your slide in that I made customers' attitude towards needs of the customer and marketing strategies, skills, as well as its dimensions as prescribed by customers coming from different caste, creed, and cultures. What is the relationship between a customer's attitude towards the needs of their needs and the mark.
One minute. This is a research question. It should begin like a question. Don't give me the focus points. You give me the questions, exact question.
What you said, ma'am? Sorry. I didn't get you, ma'am. Hello?
What is the question? Read a question.
Okay. Questions. What are the dimensions of customers' need prescribed by customers' perceptions?
Mm-hmm.
Customers' ke needs jo hai, mm-hmm. wo customers' ke perceptions se kis tarah se match kar rahe hain? Aur customer mm-hmm. ka jo attitude hai, wo customers' ke need ko kis tarah se affect karte hain? Different types of attitude.
Is it an experiment?
Yes, ma'am. Because customers, jo marketing skills hai, wo marketing skills har customer ke liye alag hota hai. Kyunki customer kaun se caste ka hai, kaun se culture ka hai. What happened, ma'am?
What is the experiment? Are you studying a correlational study? Are you studying causal comparative research? Or it is an experimental research?
cause and effect relationship, because they are relationship between cause and effect. Because if the strategy of a customer is changed, then the attitude of a customer or the culture, it also depend on that.
Achha, just describe the whole study to me, how you are going to study.
मैं पहले रिसर्च मतलब जो मार्केटिंग स्ट्रेटजीज है वो किस तरह से स्किल्स वगैरह है जो कस्टमर्स के एटीट्यूड को फाइंड आउट करती है और फिर कौन से पार्ट में कौन से एरिया में कौन से लोग रहते हैं जिस जहां पर उनकी स्ट्रेटजीज वर्कआउट करेगी कौन सी स्ट्रेटजी वर्कआउट करेगी देयर आर मेनी डिफरेंट टाइप्स ऑफ स्ट्रेटजीज
दिस इज नॉट एन एक्सपेरिमेंटल स्टडी सो डू नॉट यूज द वर्ड एफेक्ट इफेक्ट इन्फ्लुएंस इंपैक्ट
ओके
अभी रिसर्च क्वेश्चन
ओके marketing strategies as well as its dimensions towards the customer's need what type of marketing strategies affect the customer's need
effect word nahi bolne ka
acha okay what are the marketing strategies will enhance the
what are the different marketing skills used by
kaun
se field mein marketing
what ma'am
ये कौन से फील्ड की मार्केटिंग स्ट्रेटजी की बात कर रही हो
कॉमर्स डिपार्टमेंट मींस
कौन सी आर यू मार्केटिंग अ मोबाइल आर यू मार्केटिंग अ टीवी आर यू मार्केटिंग सम फूड प्रोडक्ट्स व्हाट आर यू मार्केटिंग
फूड प्रोडक्ट्स मिक्स अप एक्चुअली आई डिडंट मेंशन दैट आई एम स्टडीिंग ओनली इन मोबाइल मार्केट और इक्विपमेंट और एनी अदर थिंग्स आई जस्ट मेड द मिक्स अप ऑफ मार्केट
व्हेन यू आर कंडक्टिंग रिसर्च यू हैव टू बी वेरी क्लियर अबाउट व्हाट काइंड ऑफ मार्केटिंग व्हिच प्रोडक्ट यू आर मार्केटिंग फॉर
ओके
सो व्हाट आर द मार्केटिंग स्किल्स ऑफ फूड प्रोडक्ट्स यूज्ड बाय मार्केटिंग मैनेजर्स
ओके
what are the needs of people in a particular locality regarding that food product and which marketing skills will work better to fulfill those needs of the people the living in that locality
okay thank you ma'am
so these will be your and now write corresponding objectives later on you write it okay
thank you ma'am
next
ma'am can I
yes
ma'am my title of the research was effect of differentiated instructional strategies on the academic achievement classroom climate and social cohesion of higher secondary school students so I had taken the research question what is the impact of differentiated instructional strategies on the academic achievement of students for which my broad aim was to study the effect of differentiated instructional strategies on the academic achievement of the students so my subsidiary questions the are as follows what is the effect of content delivery on the academic achievement is there a relationship between the previous knowledge of students and the academic achievement what is the impact of group activities on the academic achievement of students then the what is the effect of learning style of students on the academic performance so these are few of my subsidiary research questions the relative objectives would be to study the effect of content delivery on the academic achievement to determine the impact of group activities on their on the performance of students to study the influence of even gender could be one of the factors So the subsidiary question could be, what is the effect of, or what is the impact of gender differences on the academic achievement of students, for which my objective could be to study the influence of gender differences on the academic achievement. So am I on the right track, ma'am?
Since this comparing on the basis of gender is not experimental in nature, you used to compare the effect of XYZ on the basis of gender.
So I should frame that question, I mean, that objective differently.
You are diversifying into many things.
Okay, so I must zero in on some specific variables.
No, not necessarily. You can have more variables, that's fine. Just read out your question.
The questions, ma'am, what is the relation between the content delivery, or what is the effect of content delivery on the academic achievement? What is the impact of group activity?
Don't rush. Wait.
Yeah. Yes.
Content delivery, is it a part of instructional strategy?
Yes, ma'am. Differentiated instruction can be done in four ways. That is either through the content, through the process, through the product, and finally the learning environment.
So where will group instruction come?
In the method of delivering the content.
Ideally, when you have four different type of differentiated instruction, your research question should be, what is the effect of four different instructional strategies, differentiated instructional strategies, on academic achievement of students? Then within that, you don't go on content delivery and group process and all that. Otherwise, focus on only one, content delivery, and then talk about group instruction, content delivery that way.
Okay.
Either just broadly compare four different strategies, or take any one strategy and do within that.
In depth within that particular concept.
You can do strategies, and within that also, it may become unmanageable then. Unless you are completely focused and you have a lot of time on your hand, then you can do it. There is no harm in doing it.
Okay. Because ma'am, I'm planning to prepare a DIS module. Okay, for teaching chemistry to junior college students. That is my, that's what I started off with. So if I'm focusing on the module, what I thought was like, I should be covering all the four aspects, because it should take into consideration the process, the product, as well as the environment.
So take all four strategies, but then don't go with each one strategy, don't go into it. And as far as gender is concerned, you can write it. Is there any combined effect of gender and differentiated instructional strategy on academic performance of students?
Okay. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Okay.
Thank you, ma'am.
Next one.
Ma'am, may I?
Yes.
I'm from Bhattak College, Krishna Kumari Bedarkar. And my aim is, the title of the study is, study the attendance of students in the college lectures. And that major research questions, I have put it as.
1 minute, yeah. Go slow. Listen when I'm asking, don't rush. What is the title? Okay.
Study the attendance of students in the college lecture.
Two study never comes in the title. That becomes an objective. Ask study
Okay.
Now,
understood, ma'am.
Please read the title.
Study of study of the attendance of students in the college lectures. And the major research question is, what is the average attendance of each students in the classroom?
Okay.
And that subsidizing research questions, I put it like this. Some questions, I just take it from the your slide only. What are the dimension of the classroom and the classroom climate? Are there any, second question is, what facilities are providing by the management to get the overall effect of improvement of the students? Then are there any difference in the students' attitude to the college and the classroom climate? Third question is, that is?
Are you studying only the trend of attendance, or you want to study factors which the classroom attendance?
Factors also will also come.
Then change the
title. So that actually I didn't read out that broad aim of the study, that is to study the effect.
Madam, wait. Change the title itself.
Okay.
Study of factors
affecting the attendance.
Affecting would be better, or a study of college students' attendance in relation to some college-related factors.
Okay. So to study the
research questions should be to identify which factors would be predictors of attendance of college students, and second would be to study these factors in relation to attendance of students. Then you go to your subsidiary.
Okay, ma'am. And that shall I continue, ma'am? That subsidizing questions.
I think you need time to revise, because what you mentioned in subsidiary questions are your factors, infrastructural facilities. Okay. Classroom climate. These are all factors.
Yeah. Okay.
हाँ मग आहे ते बरोबर आहे. But think about them.
Okay. Then I also put it that question. Okay.
बोला.
How the subject teachers approach towards each students in the classroom.
That would be difficult, because whether it is junior college or senior college, class size is so large. In fact, they don't even attend properly. So how will you measure their approach towards individual students?
By just putting some questionnaires?
No, it would be difficult. Rather, you can say how students' perception of teacher behavior.
Okay.
That you can do.
Students?
Perception of teacher behavior.
Okay. Then is there any financial problem facing by the students which affects this attendance?
You in the title you have put college related factors, financial problems.
So that has to be cancelled out. Okay. Then does the discipline of the college affects the college attendance of the student or the strictness? Okay.
Don't use the word effect, impact, influence.
Okay. So. Okay. Influence.
Now I'm going to the next slide.
Thank you, ma'am.
Influence. Effect, influence, impact, नाही वापरायचे, ते फक्त एक्सपेरिमेंट करायचे असेल तर वापरायचे.
अच्छा, ओके, थँक यू मॅम.
आई गो टू द नेक्स्ट स्लाइड. या. Okay, my next is hypothesis. What is a hypothesis? Right now, I'm conducting this session and suddenly you cannot, nor can you see anything on the screen. What could be the reason? Suppose I'm taking a session and suddenly you don't hear my voice, you can't see anything on the screen. What could be the cause? What could be the reason for this phenomenon?
Internet connectivity.
First is internet connectivity. On my part or your part?
On my part. No, on your part.
Okay, so one is internet connectivity issue on my part. Second is internet connectivity on your part. Any other reason?
Third issue?
You're not talking at all.
Any other
technological glitches?
वो internet में आ गया ना?
Means your share screen was not effective. Maybe it didn't work out.
Okay. Third. Fourth.
Battery dies out. Electricity is not there.
Lack of battery dies out skills.
No battery on my laptop. Four reasons. So, एक phenomenon है. I'm taking a session, but suddenly everything is blank. So I have identified four different reasons for that phenomenon. In other words, I have identified four different hypotheses. So a hypothesis is an educated guess. Take ka nahi? Educated guess, kuch logical guess. इंटरनेट नहीं है वो लॉजिकल है. टेक्नोलॉजिकल ग्लिच इज लॉजिकल. मेरा लैपटॉप का बैटरी निकल गया चला गया वो भी लॉजिकल है. सो दीज आर लॉजिकल और एडुकेटेड गेस ऑफ दिस फिनोमेना अबाउट पॉसिबल कॉज, पॉसिबल रिलेशनशिप और पॉसिबल डिफरेंसेस. सो वी हैव आइडेंटिफाइड फोर हाइपोथेसिस. इन अदर वर्ड्स, नीचे ग्रीन में लिखा है वो देखो, हाइपोथेसिस आर टेंटेटिव आंसर्स टू व्हाई एंड समटाइम्स हाउ रिसर्च क्वेश्चंस. यू आर ट्राइंग टू रिसर्च ऑन व्हाई देयर इज सडन लैक ऑफ वॉइस और विजुअल्स ऑन द स्क्रीन एंड यू हैड आइडेंटिफाइड फोर डिफरेंट टेंटेटिव आंसर्स. यू वर नॉट श्योर विच वन वॉज करेक्ट, देयरफॉर दे वर टेंटेटिव. सो दीज फोर वर हाइपोथेसिस विच आर टेंटेटिव आंसर्स. सो इफ यू वॉन्ट टू डिफाइन इट प्रॉपरली, a hypothesis is a tentative generalization, the validity of which you have to test. You have not tested. You just gave four guesses. Laptop chala gaya, ye, internet chala gaya, wo ho gaya, ye ho gaya. You have not tested them. But these were your logical guesses. In its most elementary stages, the hypothesis is a hunch, a guess, imaginative idea, or intuition whatsoever, which becomes the basis for your research. Am I clear about what is a hypothesis?
Yes, ma'am.
All of us are teachers.
Yes, ma'am.
I give you one example. All of us are teachers. There are some students in the class who do very well in exams. Some are average and some are below average. So what factors influence academic performance of students? Come on, tell me now. As teachers, you are experienced. Tell me.
Lack of effective method, use of effective methods.
Okay, one hypothesis.
Classroom engagement.
Okay, second hypothesis.
Indiscipline.
Discipline. Third hypothesis.
Learning interest of students.
Learning.
Learning disability in the student. And IQ.
Fourth hypothesis. IQ fifth.
Lack of interest in learning.
ओके सिक्स. सो बैठे बैठे हमको छह
हाइपोथेसिस नो बुक्स
हो गया हमको कितना. यस, सो दीज आर गेस, दीज आर इमेजिनेटिव आइडियाज और इंट्यूशन एंड दैट बिकम्स द बेसिस फॉर इन्वेस्टिगेशन. नाउ यू सिलेक्ट वन और टू ऑफ दीज एंड फाइंड आउट व्हाट इज द रिलेशनशिप बिटवीन एकेडमिक परफॉर्मेंस. दैट बिकम्स द बेसिस फॉर योर इन्वेस्टिगेशन. फिनिश्ड. वेरी सिंपल. व्हाट इज हाइपोथेसिस? वेरी सिंपल. एम आई क्लियर?
Yes.
Now we go to functions of a hypothesis. Functions of a hypothesis, they provide the researcher with a starting point, a basis, and the direction of the study. They provide evidence that you have, as a researcher, you have acquired expertise in the field of knowledge, and you are now capable of proposing explanation and creating new knowledge. They help you to determine the scope and delimitations of the study. They provide you statement of relationship between two or more variables, which you can test empirically by collecting data. And then either you can accept the hypothesis or reject it after testing the hypothesis. They focus the researcher's attention on the most relevant aspects of the study. They prevent blind research. They provide a researcher with a framework that you can use for making conclusions. They help the researcher to focus his attention on facts and conditions, which otherwise you could have overlooked. And either you accept the research hypothesis or reject it. When you accept, it provides evidence, which is very powerful, then rather based on observations. So these are overall the functions of a hypothesis. Types of hypothesis. First is a research hypothesis. One of you said IQ is related to academic performance of students. So that is your research hypothesis. Somebody said that interest in the subject is related to academic performance of students. This is also an example of research hypothesis. Somebody said learning disability is related to academic performance of students. This is also an hypothesis. So what comes to your mind as factors which influence academic performance and make statements of each one's factor with academic performance, IQ with performance, learning disability with performance, classroom environment, engagement with performance. So these are, you gave me six factors. Therefore, we will have six research hypotheses in this particular example. And you write it in a positive form. For example, IQ and academic performance are positively related. There is a positive relationship between IQ and academic performance of a student. Number one. Number two, extent of learning disability is negatively related to academic performance of students. Because if you have no disability, then performance is likely to be high. But if you have more high disability, your performance is likely to be low in a normal classroom. Then if you have lack of interest in the subject, performance will be low. And if you have high interest, performance will be high. So there is a positive relationship between interest in the subject and academic performance of students. So this is how you write your research hypothesis. So in this particular example, you wrote the hypothesis in the form of a statement. You wrote it in the form of a statement. There is a positive relationship between school climate and job satisfaction of teachers. But you can also write it in the form of a question. How? I'm giving you one example. The same example which I took in the earlier example. There is a positive relationship between school climate and job satisfaction. This is a statement. Same thing is written in the form of a question. Is there a positive relationship between school climate and job satisfaction of teachers? Or you may simply write, is there a relationship between school climate and job satisfaction of teachers? Even that is fine. Okay, third. Now what I'm showing is also types of hypothesis. But earlier the classification is on the basis of statement versus question. Now this is a different kind of examples. directional hypothesis. Based on past experience or past research, it may be found that boys have a better performance in mathematics as compared to girls. So I'm stating a direction. I'm comparing academic performance of boys and girls, and I'm stating a direction. Boys will be better than girls. So this becomes a directional hypothesis. The academic performance of boys in mathematics is greater than that of girls. Because based on past study or my observation in the class, I may see show a direction. Boys will be better than girls. So I'm showing a direction. So this is an example of a directional hypothesis. Non-direction. Now, you go to C and D, lower part. The academic achievement of boys and girls in mathematics differs. Am I showing a direction who will be better and who will be poor? No, I'm only saying they will be different. So this does not show a direction. So it is a non-directional hypothesis. Or alternatively, the same thing can be written. The academic performance of boys and girls in mathematics does not differ. Even this does not show the direction. Both examples don't show who will be higher and who will be lower. So they are non-directional. And this is a comparison. The A and B part are a relationship. There is a relationship between school climate and job satisfaction of the teachers. I'm saying a relationship, but I'm not saying whether that relationship will be positive or negative. So this is non-direction. And alternatively, I can write the same thing is, there is no relationship between school climate and job satisfaction. Even this is non-directional because I'm not showing whether the relationship will be positive or negative. So when you say one will be greater than the other, it is directional. Or whether you say a relationship between will be positive or negative, even that becomes directional. But when you say there will be a relationship, but you don't show whether the relationship is positive or negative, it is non-directional. Now, null hypothesis. Null hypothesis is a specific case of non-directional hypothesis. And essentially, null hypothesis uses the word significant. So when you write, there is no significant relationship between school climate and job satisfaction of teachers, essentially you have used the word no significant relationship. The second example, there is no significant difference in the academic achievement of boys and girls in mathematics. Here again, emphasis I'm giving is significant difference. It is because now we are going to use this hypothesis to test it statistically. Therefore, the word significant is very essential. It is a compulsory component of a null hypothesis. You need to write the word significant. I'll give you why. I'll give you a reason. Suppose I'm your teacher in the class and I'm giving you a test. Participant A got a test is of 100 marks. Participant A got 84. And B got 85. Do you think there is a very big difference between 84 and 85?
No.
No.
That 1 mark difference could have come because that person who got 84 marks had a fight with someone at home in the morning and that affected her mood. So because of the mood change, she got 1 mark less. So that 1 mark's difference may have come by chance fluctuations. But participant A gets 20 and B gets 85. Do you think the difference is large?
Yes.
There could be a genuine difference. IQ of person getting 20 marks might be much less than the person who IQ of person who gets 85 marks. So that difference is not by chance fluctuation. There could be a genuine difference due to other factors. So here between 20 and 85, there is a significant difference. which you can test using a statistical technique. Whereas 84 and 85, even statistical technique, if you use, there may not be a difference or a difference coming due to chance fluctuations. Therefore, when you write a null hypothesis, always write no significant relationship or no significant difference. These, the word no significant is essential part of a null hypothesis, because you want to do statistical analysis of the data. Therefore, it is essential to first write your research hypothesis, which comes from your logic. And then that research hypothesis is written in the null form in this particular example that I give. Null hypothesis is also an example of non-directional hypothesis, because these two examples, I'm not showing whether the relationship is positive or negative, or whether boys will be higher than girls. So it does not show direction. So all null hypotheses are always non-directional, but not all non-directional hypotheses may not be null hypotheses. That's the only thing I want to show. And statistical hypothesis. It is a statement about one or more parameters that are measures of population under study, and it is in quantitative terms. I'm giving some example. The mean academic achievement in mathematics of the population of 9th standard students taught by method A equals the mean academic achievement in mathematics of the population of 9th standard students taught by method B. So what you are trying to say here is those taught by method A, their academic achievement is equal to those taught by method B. When you say that, it is a statistical hypothesis. And part, how do you write methodology based on aims of study? I think I have already crossed the time limit. I've crossed 3 minutes. So
if you want, I just... Nobody's ma'am.
No, that is from your perspective. I don't know participant's perspective.
Ma'am, go ahead. They are enjoying.
Ma'am, please continue.
I'll quickly glance through how to match your aims with your methodology. First column is aim, second column is methodology. To ascertain the effect of a teaching method, strategy, program, technique, or teaching aid on a particular subject. When you write the word effect of, effectiveness of, impact of, then the research methodology is experimental. To compare two or more groups on a variable. To compare academic achievement of boys and girls. I've got two groups, boys and girls. On, I'm comparing boys and girls on academic performance. So that's ex post facto or causal comparative. And it's non-experimental. When you are only comparing, it's experimental. It is either ex post facto or causal comparative. Now here, you are finding out relationship between teacher performance and anxiety of teachers. Relationship, so correlational. To improve students' academic performance in a specific subject. You are teaching a subject and you want to improve their performance. So there is a practical problem in the class. You are teaching your students, you find their results are poor, you want to improve that. It is action research. You are taking action to improve something in your own class, nowhere else. Only in your class. Your sample will be only your class and no one else. So it's action research. To study physical, intellectual, language, emotional development in children, developmental study. Now I'll give you one more example here. This is old school. In the olden days, when you are studying language development in students, physical development in students, IQ development in students, they used to call it developmental study. Now, developmental study is used for different context. You may develop a program or you may develop a process or a product for improving something. You are developing either program development, process development, or product development. And then you test its effectiveness. That is known as a developmental study. So be very clear, Here I have given this example from old ideas, old research books, but latest research books use the word developmental study when you are developing something new, either new methodology, new technique, new self-learning material, process, product, or program, and you test its effectiveness. These days, that is known as developmental study. To observe individual cases in their natural environment, that is either a case study, and if you are studying culture of a particular group, then that's ethnography. To observe and analyze existing facts, events, status, processes, exploratory survey. To observe and analyze existing facts, events, status, processes, and to understand why this happens, it is explanatory. Only when you observe, it is exploratory survey. But when you want to understand why that happened, it is explanatory survey. To determine how closely the data approaches ideal data, you get normal curve, and whether there is any divergence. If that divergence is there, if it is significant, then it is an analytical survey. If you want to give a rational explanation of the past events, then that's historical research. To evaluate the quality of the refresher course orientation program organized by Academic Staff College of Pune University, it is evaluation research. You may, here it is a program. Refresher course is a program, orientation is a program. So this is program evaluation. There could be a process evaluation or there could be a product evaluation also. Thank you.
Ma'am, can you show the explanatory slide, please, ma'am?
Ma'am, third one, ma'am. Third one.
Thank you.
The explanatory is here. Third, dekhna hai.
Third one, ma'am. Third.
Anyway, thanks to all the participants. Thanks for a patient hearing. And hope to meet someday. Thank you. ये college और आपने क्या बोला? ये क्या इसके under
Ma'am, I had a question, ma'am.
Center for Innovation of Gujarat Research Society.
जी जी.
Very much for inviting.
Always a pleasure. Always a pleasure. It's our pleasure.
Ma'am, can I ask a question?
Yeah.
Ma'am, sometimes what happens when we make a proposal, at that time we realize that these are hypotheses. But when we actually get the data, that time you realize that some more can be added. So is that possible if we have sent a proposal and later on you realize that more hypotheses can be added? So can we do that, ma'am?
For PhD, there is absolutely no issue because RRC technically only evaluates your title. The title wo rakke andar jo khichdi pakana hai, unko paka.
I'm talking about a funded project. Like I later realize that I can add this also.
Add karne mein problem nahi hota hai, delete nahi karna hai. Funded project mein kam mat karo, add karne ka koi problem nahi.
Okay, okay. Thank you.
Is there any other question, Archana ma'am?
Yes, Karuna ma'am. I was just having a look at the chat box. Most of the questions madam has already answered during our session, but still just give me 1 or 2 minutes. I'll just quickly have a glance. Yeah. They are mostly the thank you messages and the appreciation, ma'am. for you. Ma'am, one question is, can developmental study be experimental study? Okay.
If you are familiar with paradigms in research, positivist, post-positivist, interpretive, transformative, and pragmatist, then developmental studies are pragmatist paradigm. They follow pragmatist.
Hello.
Hello, ma'am. May I ask a question, ma'am?
Alpa.
Yes. Ma'am, about the limitations of our study, like what age group or which area or what school we would be studying, should these limitations be mentioned in the title or it is not required to be mentioned in the title?
Not necessarily. First of all, if we decide not include something on our own, if we decide, these are delimitations and not limitations. Limitations are those which you could do, but you can could not do. That is limitation. And if there are too many of the delimitations, it is not possible to mention them in the title. You can write it in the first chapter.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you.
Hello, ma'am. I wanted to ask something.
Bula.
Ma'am, let's suppose if I'm making a theoretical framework, so all the hypotheses are going to base on that, right?
Yes.
Okay. So I'm just going to make a proposal, but my question was, let's say I have a few like objectives, and few of the objectives are not like included in the theoretical hypothesis. So it's not included in theoretical hypothesis, a theoretical framework.
Ideally, your theoretical framework should give you all the your objectives and hypotheses.
Okay.
So rewrite your theoretical.
Another question was, my theoretical framework is based on a theory which has been used by many other researchers. So is it okay to go ahead with the same, or should I make some modification in the same?
Not necessary. You can go.
But what about the plagiarism?
You might be looking at a different perspective.
Yes, yes. But what about the plagiarism part? Because all the words are going to match with other other researchers.
You have to write it in your own way.
Okay, okay, okay. Fine.
Rukaya, you have.
Yes, Archana.
Yes, Karuna, ma'am. Yeah. Ma'am, one question, developing a model will come under which type of study?
There are different types of models, right from the associative model to explanatory model. This associative model, it may be a simple survey. And if it is an explanatory model, it may use structural equation model, it may use experiment, it may use a path analysis. It depends. I cannot give a common answer. It depends on the type of model that you are developing. There are some 4 or 5 different types of models.
Thank you, ma'am. No more questions, ma'am. I can just see so much of appreciation being written by every participant, ma'am. Thank you so much, ma'am. Now over to you, Karuna, ma'am.
Thank you so much, ma'am. I'm sure you said a little bit of time from your end, but yes, participants were not ready to leave you, ma'am, with so many queries and saying that, yes, we want more. Ye dil mange more, ma'am, huh? Whenever you are around, huh? Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you so much for really a wonderful session. But we need to have a formal vote of thanks for you, ma'am. I request my colleague, Dr. Usha Borkar, to propose the formal vote of thanks to Dr. Pandya. Over to you, Usha Borkar, ma'am. Over to you.
Thank you, Dr. Sinha. Thank you, Dr. Sinha. Am I audible?
Yes, yes, you are audible, Usha. Please go ahead. Please go.
Hello, am I audible?
Yes, yes, you are audible, Usha. You are audible. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you. So, warm good afternoon to one and all. On behalf of our parent body, Gujarat Research Society, Principal Ma'am Dr. Anita Swami, and entire HJC team, and all the participants of the capacity building program and the pre-PhD course organized by HJC Center of Innovation under the aegis of RUSA, I am privileged to have received the opportunity to convey our heartfelt gratitude to our vibrant resource person, Dr. Shefali Pandya Ma'am. Participants, I would like to share with all of you that I have had the good fortune of being Shefali Ma'am's student while studying M.Ed, where I have been blessed by her encouragement and willingness to help me at all junctions. Today, when Ma'am was having her session, I was once again transported to my M.Ed class. Ma'am, in an extremely eloquent manner, using pertinent citations and examples, providing participants to frame and prepare research questions, aims, Shefali Ma'am helped us all to distinguish between the different types of research questions and other basics of research, thus helping all of us to embark on research in a more rational manner. Ma'am, your immense experience and exhaustive knowledge has left us wanting to have more interaction with you. We hugely appreciate you taking time of your extremely demanding schedule to share your expertise with us. By patiently answering the queries of the participants and welcoming queries at regular intervals during the session, ma'am, you created a comfort zone for all the participants. And I'm sure all of us did not hesitate to get our uncertainties clarified from you. It is said, some people brighten up the room with their presence. Ma'am, you are one of them, and even managed to do so from distance in an online mode. Thank you, ma'am, for your guidance, wisdom, and compassion as we all continue with our research journey. Ma'am, we also take this opportunity to salute you for the wonderful and inspiring contribution to the field of education. We are truly honored by your presence today. We all at HJC are proud of our association with you. Thank you once again from all of us. Heartfelt gratitude to you, ma'am. With this, I now request the coordinator of capacity building program and pre-PhD course, Dr. Karuna Sinha, to kindly take over.
Thank you, Usha ma'am. Thank you so much. Ma'am, now we have those something for the participants. Dear participants, those who wish to see, this is the because we have not had an opportunity to talk to you directly. So this is a capacity building program and pre-PhD course. Now, those who wish to do it as pre-PhD course also, I'm sure that capacity building, it is going to be for everyone. Now, those who wish to continue it and add it as their pre-PhD course, because this is going to be a part of the pre-PhD course. You know that as per the university norms, there are some specific hours, credits, which we need to complete and say that this is a complete pre-PhD course. So we have clubbed it as a part of the pre-PhD course, and this is going to be one part of that. Now, those who wish to add it and do it as pre-PhD course also, we three of us request those to stay back with us for a couple of minutes. Others, can please move out and can exit from the meeting, because we have some announcements for those pre-PhD students.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
And we meet all of them, we meet again on Monday morning.
Thank you, ma'am.
All the best. Have a nice day. Have a nice weekend. Stay safe. Stay healthy also. All of you.
You too, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you. Can we assume that we have Usha ma'am and Archana ma'am? because we have around 77, three of us are there, 77 of them are here. So do we assume that they are all there for pre-PhD course? Can we have the reactions, please, then? Please stay back if you want to add it as a pre-PhD course also. Okay. Fine enough. Now let's see then towards the end. Dear participants, those who, because you have stayed back and you want to add it as you a part of your pre-PhD course also, just a couple of announcements for you, because you know that it is a mandatory component of your research work. And we have to do it as per the norms and guidelines of the University of Mumbai. All right. And we are supposed to complete the specific credits and hours as per the norms of University of Mumbai. So this is going to be one part of your pre-PhD course, and other parts are going to happen in the coming months. Because as per the norms of the University of Mumbai, we can complete our pre-PhD course in 6 months. But we are not going to take 6 months, but in the coming months, we'll definitely complete the other parts also. Now, in order to complete this one part, first part of pre-PhD course, first of all, your attendance for all the days is mandatory. Your attendance is going to be recorded. All right. And that is why in the morning, Usha ma'am said to you all, please write down your names as per the registration form. All right, because you have been registered with specific names. And when you are attending the meetings, the sessions, please write down your names, because your attendance is going to be marked, is going to be recorded also. Because towards the end, when we give you the certificate that you have completed one part of pre-PhD course, that means you have completed the prerequisite hours and credits. So for that, it is mandatory that we need to have you around for the complete session. Don't see to it that you come in the morning, leave in the afternoon, come in the towards the end of the session. No, because we are going to record the attendance in the morning, in the afternoon, towards the end also. All right. So this is one thing which we want to tell you. Please be punctual if you want to have the pre-PhD course certificate also. Second is, as per the norms, you are supposed to have certain assignments to be submitted, because that is again a part of the pre-PhD course, prerequisite of pre-PhD course. All right. And what we have decided, the team at GCE in charge, we have decided that for all these sessions, every day you will be getting one assignment related to the session which has been conducted over there. All right. Now, towards the end of the day or the next day morning, we're definitely going to put the assignment in the group. And that assignment is only for pre-PhD students. All right. And we are going to give you time. It is not that towards the end 29th go you have to submit all the assignments. No, it's not going to be like that. All right. So even on 29th, you are going to get an assignment. And we are definitely going to give you preferably around between 10 to 15 days to complete those assignments. We will provide you the email ID on which the assignment has to be submitted. All right. And you are supposed to, before the deadline, we will give you the deadline that will be posted in the group, and before the deadline on the deadline date, assignments need to be reached to us through email ID, which will be provided. Your assignments are going to be evaluated by the team in charge, all right? And then after, you may say that after evaluating the assignments, you need to give us a week's time before we dispatch, we send you, we email you the certificates of the part completion of your pre-PhD course. I hope I have made it clear. That's why we wanted to talk to you, those who want to do it as pre-PhD course. Usha ma'am, first you, and then Archana ma'am, you. If I have missed out anything, please add that. Usha ma'am, over to you.
Yeah, Karuna ma'am, thank you very much. You have covered up everything, but there are few queries. queries that have come up in the chat box,
okay,
which I think we need to answer for the students. So may I help you with the questions, or we'll have Archana ma'am doing that?
Anyone
can. Archana ma'am, would you do that?
We'll put this prepaid.
Yeah.
Okay. See, I can see one question here, Sara. I think it is from Sara. Sara. If I can see, Usha ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Saira Khan. Saira Khan.
Yes.
Saira, yes. I'm a B.Ed. student. Am I eligible for this pre-PhD course? Pre-PhD course is, Saira, for those who have registered for PhD, all right? And it is mandatory for them to do this pre-PhD course during their PhD term, when they are doing the PhD course. Are you a registered PhD student, Saira?
No, ma'am, I'm in SYBA'd and I've done some research works, but I've not registered for my PhD, but willing to do PhD in future.
See, you are at liberty to join this course. I'm not saying if you want to be a part of the course, but right now this course will not serve you the purpose for which it is being done usually.
Yes, ma'am. Got it, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Yes, but you are most welcome to be a part of the course. You are most welcome to be a part of the course. All right.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
All right, Saira. All right. And
ma'am, may I ask?
Just a minute, Saira.
Ma'am.
Just a minute. Now it is Sanjeevani. Usha ma'am, you can also address to some of the questions also. Archana ma'am, please, you can also. Usha ma'am. Sanjeevani.
I think the question. Yeah, I think Karuna ma'am, with your response earlier, you have answered several questions.
Okay.
Because in order for this to be recognized as a pre-PhD course, you've already said the students need to be registered PhD students. So they have to register. Otherwise, what is going to happen is this is going to become invalid and null for y'all.
Exactly.
So you should be pursuing research. That means your doctoral work. Okay, under any guide from any university, that's not a problem. Okay, and if you are none of these, that means you have not cleared your PET, or you cleared your PET or not registered anywhere, or you are a student somewhere, or you're a faculty somewhere but not registered as a doctoral student, this will not serve the purpose. But of course, as Karuna ma'am said, we all welcome you to this learning experience. So, you know, you're most welcome to attend, and there is, I think, Karuna ma'am, you may let them know about the other certificate also.
Yes, yes, that I'm going to tell.
You know, yes, yes, yes. So, Karuna ma'am will tell you that if you're not a PhD student, then what? Then how it is going to be looked at.
Thank you.
Karuna ma'am, over to you.
Yes. Archana ma'am, would you like to add anything?
No, Karuna ma'am, same observations as you and Usha ma'am said. Definitely the ones who have not done the pre-PhD course, for them it will not serve the purpose, and the other part you will be sharing with them now.
All right. Manya has written up, Usha ma'am and Archana ma'am, Manya has written up. Parveen, just give us a minute.
Sure, sure.
Manya has written, I'm already pursuing PhD, so can I do it? Yes, you can do it, Manya. We have already said it now. Manya, are you there?
Yeah, yeah, ma'am.
All right.
Ma'am, am I audible?
Yes, you are audible, Manya.
Yeah, ma'am. Actually, I got your point that I can do, but I have one query that only we have to submit assignments.
Yes, yes.
Only assignments we have to submit?
Yes, only right now for this particular one part. You have to submit
the assignment. As so this, along with this 6-7 days session, assignments also we have to complete. Yes. So it will be added in this particular coursework, right?
Yes, yes, yes. Okay. We are going to have, as I said, we are going to have it in other parts also. So in other parts, we are going to have the evaluation also. In other parts, we are going to have the student's presentation also. So those who are completing it, just want to complete one part right now. So they are going to have the assignment submissions only, which will be evaluated by the team.
Okay. All so will you inform in our mail or somewhere you will make some another WhatsApp group?
No, no, no. We will have this group only. And okay. When we have the session, on the day of the session, towards the end of the day or next day morning, we will have assignment number. For example, today's session, it will be assignment number one. All right. So, and okay. We will write down for pre-PhD students there. Only for pre-PhD students. This assignment is there only for pre-PhD students.
Okay.
All right.
Okay, ma'am, one more question I want to ask. As I already did one PhD course work of 1 month, in that I have submitted assignments and given one online test also.
Yes.
That's so good. Will it be more, means if I will join your course also, it will be more effective or useful for like countable for my coursework?
Mania, let me tell you one thing, that if you have done that for 1 month, all right, so they have assignments and the evaluation. That's what I said.
Yes.
For 6 days right now, and we are going to have it continued in the coming months also, because as per the norms of the university, we can have it in the 6 months. All right, so we will have evaluation also, we will have your presentations also, but right now for this particular one part we have decided only for assignments. Now your second question, I will answer your second question. You have said, will it be more beneficial? Will it be more beneficial? I'm not sure about that, but every new learning experience is always beneficial.
Okay, ma'am.
All right. So every new learning experience is unique, is beneficial. No learning goes waste.
Yeah, ma'am. Yeah,
every new learning experience will give you something new. At least one.
Yeah, ma'am.
All right. And that's going to be beneficial.
Am I
making sense to you, Mania? Usha, ma'am, would you like to add anything to what Mania is asking?
No,
ma'am,
no, you've already
answered. Ma'am, actually why I'm asking this, because in every 6 months we have to do some presentation that what exactly work I have done towards my research, right? So if I will show this work that I have joined this six days ka course, and I did this whatever it is, means you are covering in your course, so it will be considered in my PhD coursework. That's what I'm asking. That's why.
So I think I have cleared your question, Mania.
Yeah, ma'am. Yeah. Thank you so much, ma'am. Yeah, thank
welcome.
You.
You're welcome, dear. All right. I think the other question.
Karuna, ma'am.
Yeah.
There's one more question. Hmm. Okay. May I read it out to you?
Haan, boli na, because I'm also seeing, but.
See, once again, she's saying, Sonal Jain is saying that I am selected as a PhD candidate in the college under a guide, but not registered yet. Hmm. So can I do it?
Because she is already selected.
Yeah, she can do it.
Selected.
Yes.
She can.
And I think Sonal... Yes, and may I add that Sonal can also speak to her guide. She can speak to her guide and let her know that she's doing this PhD course.
Hmm.
Okay, so that, you know, her guide is also informed that after the selection of a candidate, she's doing this PhD course.
You're right.
So that can be done.
Yes.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Okay, I have one. Dhania has written down. If MPhil is done, then pre-PhD is required to be done. Now, Dhania, MPhil for them, it is the pre-PhD course is exempted right now, as per the right the norms which are existing right now. All right. But I will, Dhania, request you to complete your pre-PhD course also, because we don't know when the norms, at what time the norms are changing, because we see the norms are changing every day. So I will request you to go ahead with the pre-PhD course. Although right now, MPhil students are exempted, those who have completed MPhil. But yes, in order to be sure that at no point of time, I will be in a trouble if the norms are changed. So I'll request you to please go ahead with the pre-PhD course. I hope, Dhania, I have made it clear to you.
Yes, thank you, ma'am.
Okay.
Excuse me, ma'am.
I have cleared my PET exam, but not registered.
Karuna ma'am, there is one question.
Huh.
Like, do we have to pay if we want free PhD certificate?
No, they don't have to pay. No, my dear, we don't charge for conducting these sessions from the students. All right, you don't have to pay for it.
Excuse me, ma'am.
Yes.
I have a question, ma'am. Actually, I have just completed 1 year coursework in my PhD right now. So, ma'am, is this course the same thing or will it add on into that?
I think I have just now answered this question. I have just now, Swari ma'am, I have just now answered this question. I said, although you must have done it, every right now, I don't know what you have done. We know we are here, team is here, but we don't know exactly, the team doesn't know what exactly you have done, my dear. All right. But yes, the coursework, the topics may be somehow similar hota hai. But let me tell you one thing today. When we were listening to Shefali madam, we have listened research question, we being in the team, we have listened to research questions, hypothesis, but there were so many new things which were brought in front of us by Pandya madam. So as I have said that every learning experience, new learning experience has something unique to offer you. So if you ask me whether I should do it, I will say, please go ahead. You must do it.
Okay, ma'am, may I come in, ma'am?
Yes, Paruna, who is ma'am? Now? Yes, who?
Ma'am, Parveen.
Parveen. Yes, Parveen.
Ma'am, I just wanted to know that now our vacations are going on because schools are shut.
Yes.
So this timing is very suitable. But in future, what would be the timing of the course?
Don't worry, Parveen. We know right now why we have planned in this way. We were knowing that the educational institutions are going to be shut for their summer vacation and all that. All right, that's why we have kept it in this way that it is suitable and comfortable for everybody. When we have the second and the third, don't worry, we are going to take the things into consideration, the timings into consideration, and then only we are going to plan. All right, so don't worry about it. Absolutely don't worry about it. So I think we have answered all the queries, Usha ma'am and Archana ma'am, because they are the repetition.
Yes.
Repetitive questions.
Yes, Karuna ma'am,
you
have answered.
Atmaja. Yeah, ma'am.
Yes,
Atmaja. Am I audible, madam?
Yes, you are.
Yeah, ma'am, this assignment, are we supposed to type it or we can write and scan it and submit?
Okay, now listen, we are going to have it in the online mode. You are going to submit it in the online mode. All right. So whether you want to submit it in a scan way or typed way. All right. But I will suggest that we need to have the PDF formats of both so that it is very easy for us to evaluate them. So if you want to type it, save it as a PDF format and then send it to us. If you want to write it and then scan, it is going to be, you will have to take the burden, more burden of writing, scanning, and then emailing. Whatever is comfortable to you, please go ahead with that.
Okay, madam. Yeah. Thank you so much, ma'am. Yeah.
Good afternoon, ma'am.
Yes, Rubina.
Ma'am, I just cleared my PET exam and I'm not yet registered.
Okay.
So am I eligible to this?
Now, when do you want to register?
Whenever the colleges are reopened. We're just waiting for the lockdown to...
Okay. If you register in coming days, in coming couple of months, I'm sure that this pre-PhD course is going to be valid and it is going to work for you. Because as you are planning to register in immediate time, na?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, Usha ma'am.
Yes, Karuna ma'am.
Am I clear? I said because she is planning to register in immediate coming days or a month or so. So yes, she's saying, can she go for this pre-PhD course?
Actually, if she does this and we give the certificate, it will also depend upon the center, whether they will consider this as the pre-PhD course for them.
Correct.
Because right now, because of COVID scenario, things are delayed. Hmm. So we really don't know when exactly her registration is going to happen.
That's what I was asking her.
Yes.
So I think even she can ask her guide, whom she had already spoken that she wants to register. Rubina, can you just talk to your guide also?
Yes.
All right. Yes. Is there anyone else before we wind up now?
Can consult.
Can we keep the recorded
so that you know?
Good afternoon, ma'am. Can I come in? This is Shalyan Fernandez.
Yes, Shalyan, please.
Ma'am, I have completed. I've given my PET exam this year, and I've cleared it as well as I have registered at St. Xavier's Institute. Mm-hmm. And Geeta ma'am had asked me to register for the PET program, but because of the current pandemic situation, they have not, you know, my application form has been submitted, but the confirmation to it has not received yet because of the current scenario. So that's why I wanted to ask. And I have also, you know, she is the one who guided me for this program. So she said you can continue doing it.
Yes. Then because she already knows, she has asked you to knows this scenario. I think when she has said, her guide has said, please go ahead. So please go ahead. Please go ahead.
Because as far as the registration, it's not done yet, but I have filled the application form and all the mandatory requirements has been done.
Yes, Shalyan. And your respective guide has said you to please go ahead. So please go ahead.
Yes.
All right.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Welcome. You're welcome. You're welcome. I think we are through with the day. Usha ma'am and Archana ma'am.
Yes. Yes.
All right. All right. Participants, thank you so much. And then looking forward to see you all on Monday. Your question will be posted towards the end of the day or tomorrow in the morning. Have a relaxed Sunday. Do take care of yourself. Stay safe. Stay healthy also. So I request all of you to take care of yourself. Now, Usha ma'am and Archana ma'am, should we wind up the meeting? I think Usha...
Usha ma'am, I think, Karuna ma'am, I can't see her.
You can't, I can see her, but unka shayad video, internet connectivity chal
gaya. Just a small request to all the part.
Usha ma'am, please go ahead.
Okay.
Yes,
fill up the feedback form.
Yes, please.
Which
please.
Is mandatory. You could hear me, Karuna ma?
I can. Yes.
Yeah, I'm requesting all the participants, kindly fill up the feedback form. The link for the same is posted on the WhatsApp group. And please, feedback form is compulsory for you all to get the certificates also. So thank you for that. Archana ma'am, over to you.
Yeah. Ma'am, I want to ask you some questions, please. Ma'am, sorry, I raised my hand, but...
who is that? Neha?
Neha.
Yeah, quickly, ma'am, Neha, go ahead.
Ma'am, what we write in that name of the university, because I'm just clear my PET exam and I didn't register myself.
Where you want to write down?
In feedback.
Feedback form. Karuna, ma'am, I think she's asking, for the feedback form.
Okay, you are not registered right now anywhere.
Yes, ma'am.
So simply write down not registered yet. No need of writing. All right.
Okay. And ma'am, how I know that the interview and how I will get the guide from without giving interview or any other registration form?
No, I'm not getting. Where do you want to register?
Ma'am, means. अब गाइड कैसे मिलेगा जब तक ही हमारा इंटरव्यू नहीं होगा हाउ कैन आई फाइंड गाइड विदाउट इंटरव्यू
नेहा आपको खुद वो देखना पड़ेगा कि आप कहां करना चाह रहे हो कौन से इंस्टीट्यूशन में करना चाह रहे हो यू विल हैव टू अप्रोच द इंस्टीट्यूशन यू विल हैव टू देन टॉक टू देम दे विल गाइड यू वेयरएवर यू वांट टू गो सो ऑल द इंफॉर्मेशन विल बी प्रोवाइडेड बाय द रिस्पेक्टिव इंस्टीट्यूशन वेयरएवर यू वांट टू डू योर पीएचडी First of all, you yourself need to decide the institution where you want to do. And then approach the institution. They will provide you all the guidelines.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am.
You're welcome, Neha. You're welcome. All right. Usha, ma'am, should we then exit and request Archana, ma'am, to kindly end the meeting?
Yes, sure. I'll be doing. Yeah.